Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today. In today's webcast, we are going to talk a little bit about automating risk reporting in insurance and banking industry. My name is Nanda Nainadurai, and I'm a business intelligence and analytics consultant with Thorogood. I've been working with Thorogood for a number of years on enterprise BI strategies and implementation, and I'm joining today's webcast from our London office where Thorogood is headquartered. I have included my email and LinkedIn on the screen. So if you have any questions after the event that you want to reach out, certainly feel free to. We're going to start off by just saying a little bit about Thorogood. So for those of you who have not worked with us, we are an independent global professional services firm, and we specialize in business intelligence and analytics strategies, solutions, and services. We have been doing this for a little over 30 years now, and we are a global company with offices in London, Boston, Philadelphia, Sao Paulo, Singapore, and Bangalore, India. We offer full range of BI and analytics services. So that includes things like strategies and roadmaps, as well as end-to-end solutions from requirements through to implementation, training, user adoption, and support. We do work with a number of blue chip customers drawing from a different range of sectors. And the sectors we most commonly work with are the consumer goods, pharma and life sciences, financial services, and insurance sector. We have a lot of relevant experience across all range of customers, but also specifically in the banking and insurance space as well. You can see that we have a varied mix of projects ranging from strategy planning, business modeling, reporting and analytics. We have also run projects focused on regulatory areas such as Solvency II and SPF planning, and also a wide range of experience across various functions, including finance, underwriting, claims, and broker management. I'm not going to walk through each of the lines here, but I hope this gives you a high-level view on the variety of projects that we are involved in the industry. We are an independent consultancy. In that, we mean that we work with a range of different technology partners, and our consultants are knowledgeable and experienced in a wide breadth of technologies and really the way those technologies can be integrated successfully. I've listed some of our partnerships here, including back-end, front-end, and some analytics-driven technologies. Today's session isn't going to focus on any one particular technology. We're going to talk a bit more theoretically about risk management and automation. If you do have any questions about the offerings of these specific vendors and how they might pertain to some of the topics today, certainly reach out and we can do some follow-up sessions or more in-depth conversations on those. So the objective for today's session is pretty straightforward. We're looking to give you an introduction about risk management in banking and insurance sectors to level set with the topics most commonly used in the industry, and then share some of the key challenges that are currently being faced in automating risk reporting. And also, we are going to spend some time to discuss some of the potential solutions for overcoming those challenges. Let's take a step back and look into how today's world functions and how companies really operate. I would say that almost every company operates based on different market movements, and each of them have varying degree of risk exposure to the way the company operates. Literally, risks are everywhere around us. The success of an enterprise in such a business world is to really balance that risk and be able to thrive in an ever-changing economy. This risk may mean different things for different companies. For example, a consumer products and goods company may look at its stock at risk and set itself a goal to improve and minimize the write-off amount on a regular basis. This would help them to improve their stock availability and channel their capital investments to appropriate functions of the business. However, things are slightly different for banking and insurance companies. In fact, both financial risks like credit, liquidity, equity, and non-financial risks like legal, cyber, and information security, strategic risk, are inherent to the core of the business model. The nature of transactions between these entities are such that without proper risk control frameworks, any mismanagement of such risk on a widespread scale could result in a systemic collapse and in turn to an economic catastrophe. This has been even more clearer in the past decade or so since the 2008 global financial crisis. But the history of banking crisis is rich and deep. In one of the recent keynote speeches, chairman of the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, a committee of banking supervisory authorities, claims that since 1920, the average share of countries around the world experiencing a systemic banking crisis in any given year is about 7%. There have been over 150 systemic banking crises around the globe since 1970. On the brighter side, things have changed since then, and the industry has focused on strengthening risk management practices to build on the lessons learned by the industry and by sharing experiences with supervisors on a global scale. Having looked at the bigger picture of the purpose of compliance and where they really fit in with our economy, it is important to understand that it is not just necessary to comply with regulators, but use this as an opportunity to define appropriate risk frameworks within the organization, and various teams and leaders have a crucial play to play in this. Complying with the regulators is just the beginning of a journey. Today, we are going to briefly look into two such supervisory bodies, one from banking and one from insurance, which have played a significant role in coming up with the required checks and balances in the industry, and in turn have helped the board members to become more aware of underlying risk in the business. First, let's look into BCBS 239. In 2013, the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, the committee I mentioned earlier, issued principles for effective risk data aggregation and risk reporting. The set of principles in the paper provide a foundation for a framework to address and help resolve critical weaknesses that banks have in understanding and accurately describing their overall exposures and key risk factor. BCBS 239 lists out four major categories and 14 principles. Let's quickly look into the major categories and the principles that govern them. The first major category is about governance and infrastructure. A bank's risk data aggregation capabilities and risk reporting practices should be subject to strong governance arrangements. Also, a bank should design, build, and maintain data architecture and IT infrastructure, which fully supports its risk data aggregation capabilities and risk reporting practices, not only in normal times, but also during times of stress or crisis. The second major category is risk data aggregation capabilities. What this means is being able to generate accurate and reliable risk data to meet normal and crisis reporting accuracy requirements. Data should be aggregated on a largely automated basis so as to minimize the probability of errors. A bank should be able to capture and aggregate all material risk data across the banking group. Data should be available by business line, legal entity, asset type, industry, region, and other groupings as relevant for the risk in question. This would allow in identifying and reporting risk exposures, their concentration levels, and any emerging risks that are in the horizon. Next, risk reporting practices. The risk management report should accurately and precisely convey aggregated risk data and reflect risk in an exact manner. This includes principles like comprehensiveness, clarity, and usefulness of the reports. The frequency of report production and distribution is defined by the board and the senior management. The last and final category focuses on periodical reviews by supervisors and evaluating the bank's compliance. Supervisors should use the appropriate tools and resources to indicate effective and timely remedial action by a bank to address deficiencies in its risk data aggregation capabilities and risk reporting practices. Today, we are going to mainly focus on the second category, banks' risk aggregation, its challenges and opportunities. Before we move further, let's quickly look at one of the recent changes in the insurance sector accounting as well. The International Accounting Standards Board published International Financial Reporting Standard in May 2017, most commonly called as IFRS 17. This was designed to achieve the goal of a consistent principle-based accounting for insurance contracts. This standard requires insurance liabilities to be measured at a current fulfillment value and provides a more uniform measurement approach for all insurance contracts. IFRS 17 is aimed to increase transparency around the profitability of insurance business by separating the presentation of underwriting and finance results and by not considering premium volumes as top-line investment components. IFRS 17 supersedes the existing IFRS 4 insurance contracts and is effective from 1st of January 2022. In fact, the last date of compliance has been recently extended by a year. Why does all of this matter now? So we know that supervisory bodies are created and are expected to maintain the required balance for the banks and insurance companies that are liable to report to them. First of all, this creates a need for them to comply with the regulators. Oftentimes, the process used internally for this compliance is not very efficient. There is always room for improvement, and people tend to envision better solutions as they work along with an existing process. And finally, the technology advancements have grown so rapidly over the past few years that many things that were unimaginable a decade back is becoming possible. These three moving parts make a compelling case to reevaluate the existing process with the help of the available technology. Now let's look into a specific example on how risks are currently aggregated and reported within a bank. Risk reporting teams to pass the information required for reporting and submit individual reports to the central risk team. The types of information submitted varies from being a snapshot of a visualization chart, which could be from another BI system, or it could be comments entered. It could be both quantitative and qualitative. The central risk team is responsible for the reporting process and collects information from various teams and aggregates risk. For example, RAC status for each risk in question is reported, and credit risk team provides relevant scoring and limits information to the central risk team. Then, the central risk team reviews the submitted information and collects any additional information required from the risk teams. This feedback loop is usually unstructured and is mostly buried within emails and review meetings. In this overall process, the central risk team prepares a presentable report format and submits it to the board. This report is usually delivered as a highly formatted report, with the output being a PowerPoint presentation or a PDF file. In fact, it is not uncommon to see hard copies of this report being distributed to the board members. The story kind of repeats itself for each reporting cycle. The risk reporting team submits key metrics and comments, central risk team reviews, and after appropriate feedback processing, the final report gets distributed to the board. While this is a fairly simple and straightforward process and adheres to comply for each reporting cycle, this approach is not only inefficient but breaks down completely at time of stress or crisis. This provides an opportunity with a lot of room for improvement. As I mentioned earlier, complying with regulators is a journey and not a destination by itself. Now let's look into some of the key challenges that have been raised on this journey. The current process is not as efficient as it could be. One of the primary drivers for that is the variety of unknown landscapes and pressure on the company and its leaders to comply by the tight deadlines. While some approaches might have made sense during the initial implementation for compliance and provided value in the short term, it might prove to be a costlier affair in the long run. This brings us to the point about inappropriate balance between automated and manual process. For example, things like data sourcing, cleansing, and loading could be automated using data lineage principles without manual intervention. But somewhere along these steps, there would be still some manual intervention, which are not required. Also, it is important to note that there are some features that the risk teams are expected to be involved in. For example, risk teams are required to add quantitative and qualitative comments based on the risk type and any actions captured as part of the comments. So there is a little bit of manual intervention required when looking at the overall process, and it is important to identify the right balance in the long run. The frequency of the delivery of reports poses a key challenge as well. For each report cycle, reports are usually prepared by the risk teams manually and are then submitted to the central risk team for review. Various meetings are held to confirm and agree on key metrics and comments. This is a time-consuming process and are prone to manual errors. In addition to this, there are no audit trails of information exchanged and agreements being made. Most of the decisions are made via emails and interview meetings. Having a system or tool in place which could be used to collaborate with different risk teams is still an unfulfilled dream for many teams. Aggregating risk for an enterprise dealing with billions of pounds of market cap is definitely not an easy task. There are different legacy systems which needs to be pulled in, and there are different teams which contribute to this entire exercise. Not having a single go-to place to speed up the aggregation process is a bottleneck to achieve efficiency. Downstream metric production. Most of the charts and insights that get into the risk reporting process are all part of an existing BI system. For example, screenshots from existing credit risk report is usually attached as an image to the final pack that goes to the board review. Any change in the credit risk parameters do not get reflected in the pack until the next reporting cycle happens, or someone manages to find a new screenshot of the report and is provided to the pack. Interacting with multiple systems and preparing the data required to report comes with various data quality issues as well. Let's spend a few minutes looking into a couple of possible approaches in overcoming these challenges. The way the first option is structured is such that the risk reporting teams submit the risk information for each reporting cycle using a custom web portal where the reporting cycle, risk type, and related fields can be chosen from a drop-down. If there are any snapshots of visualization charts that the team would like to use, they could upload it to the tool. Also, quantitative and qualitative comments are provided as text box inputs. The central risk team reviews the submitted information on this web portal. Any review inputs are then fed via the same portal and appropriate corrections are made in a timely manner. Once all the teams are happy with the report contents, the central risk team extracts the report to be submitted to the board in a predefined report format. They perform some smoke testing to make sure everything is aligned and then submits it to the board members. This approach is one step further from the current manual process, but has some challenges as there is still reliance on risk reporting teams to submit the visualizations via the portal. In the second approach, which is more of a very broad and ambitious one, we begin to look at the data from various underlying data sources rather than risk teams. This approach enables us to dive deep into the actual data sources of each risk type and opens up various aggregation possibilities. What we are going to look into is a layered approach. So after identifying the data sources, the data is acquired from the source systems and gathered into a data acquisition layer. The purpose of this layer is to accumulate the required data for further processing. There is no business logic applied on this layer. Once we have access to the raw sources, the data is massaged and manipulated into a form suitable for further analysis and processing. The required business logics are applied in this layer. And then a semantic layer is built on top of it for business representation of the data that helps end users access data autonomously using common business terms. While this enables end users autonomously access the reports, in our case, that could be either risk reporting teams or central risk team. The reporting tools are then used to connect to the data in semantic layer to surface the relevant business information. And access to these reports are provided to the relevant risk reporting teams, central risk team, and the board risk committee. The need to prepare a pixel-perfect report pack would still be met with this approach, among other things. The most important aspect is, with this approach, would also enable the board to aggregate risk at the time of a crisis as well. There are multiple factors to consider, irrespective of the approaches taken. Let's quickly look into some highlights of these factors. The key focus areas of data governance includes availability, how frequently should the data be made available, usability, how is it being used across different risk types, and consistency of the data being made available. The existing complex structure of the data poses a challenge, and hence, implementing data governance policies is required upfront. Now let's look into a few data governance principles. Data lineage states where data is coming from, where it is going, and what transformations are applied to it as it flows through multiple processes. It helps understand the data lifecycle. It is one of the most critical pieces of information from a metadata management point of view. From data quality and data governance perspectives, it is important to understand data lineage to ensure that existing business rules exist where expected, calculation rules currently implemented, and any other transformations are correct, and system inputs and outputs are compatible. Data quality checks are expected to be completed at an appropriate level of the data lineage process. It's not enough to have broad data quality criteria. You need specific metrics to test against, and it is a continuous process. After a solution has been implemented for a defined period of time, say for example, 1 month of real-time validation, we could run another test against the initial metrics. Have the results changed? Was there an improvement in the data quality criteria? Based on what happened, we could adjust or change the solution accordingly. Data dictionary acts as a centralized repository of information about data, such as its meaning, its relationships to other data, what is the origin of it, its usage and format. As there are over 2 dozen of risk types being reported on a monthly basis, and the existing process includes involving multiple teams to report, it is important and valuable to maintain a data dictionary which captures the way the data is structured. As mentioned earlier, in most of the cases, the final output to the board is usually a hard copy backed by a PowerPoint deck or a PDF file. Reporting tools like Power BI and Tableau provides the functionality to export it in either format. It is important to choose the right tool for the right job and architect the solution by envisioning how success looks like. At Thorogood, having worked with large insurance and banking companies, we have experience ranging from the topics discussed today to specific cases like building an end-to-end system to report cyber vulnerabilities. With the help of required business knowledge and the ability to understand various possibilities with technology, we could help you solve business problems with the help of the right tool. On the cyber vulnerability, if you are further interested to hear more about it, we have a recorded webcast available on our website. feel free to check it out. That concludes today's webcast. Thank you all again for taking the time to attend. And if you do have any questions or want a discussion on anything that have been covered today, then please contact me. Thank you.